at death surrendered to the mighty cross of Jesus Christ, the earth would shake beneath the weight of darkened skies. On his brow, a crown of sorrow for a king whose weakness was our strength. No word he spoke, his love was shown for all to see. All the cross of Jesus Christ is the
But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. And that comes from Isaiah 53, verse 5. And if we look at 1 Peter 2:24, with his own self, bear our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness. Again, by whose stripes ye were healed. And we're healed by his stripes. And we reflect over 2,000 years ago, where our Lord and Savior was betrayed, denied, abused, accused, but without guilt. He was crucified, and in 1 Peter 1, verse 19, but with the precious blood of Christ as a lamb without blemish and without spot, no sin was found in our Lord and Savior. Good morning. Good morning to you all in the auditorium right here and online as well. We welcome you to another Good Friday morning service here at Havenhill Baptist Church, and Good Friday because the greatest good was done on a day like this. Our Lord and Savior bled upon that cross of Calvary so we can look forward to the blessed hope of his return. So we welcome you. We are here at Havenhill Baptist Church, 28 Mannings Hill Road, Kingston 8. And we look forward to a blessed service this morning where we can reflect, remember, and go through that process, go through that pain with our Lord and Savior. I'm going to open with a word of prayer. Let's pray. Father, you know, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for this beautiful day that you have made, Father. And we will rejoice and be glad you did. And a special day when we can reflect totally on you and that precious work that was done on the cross for our sins, Father. And Father, even as we come before you this morning, we pray for your forgiveness for our sins, Father, because we know we have sinned, Father. There's none, the scripture says, none righteous, no, not one. And our righteousness are like filthy rags, so we cannot claim righteousness in ourselves, Father, because we know there's one righteous, and that's you, Father. And you have imputed that righteousness on your people who have come to know you as their Lord and Savior, Father. So we just pray right now that you cleanse us, Father. Remove any iniquity from our heart, any ill feeling as we come to you, Father. We want to worship you in spirit and truth, Father. Clean minds, clean hearts, clean hands as we come to minister in your name, Father. And we just pray that you go before us now in this morning service. Go before the praise and worship team to come as we give you praise. And Father, even the man, your manservant right now, minister to him while he prepares to bring the message from you, Father. So we just pray blessings on this service. Go before us. Guide us, protect us, and keep us. And let every mind and heart be open and attentive to what will be said and done here this morning. Father, we thank you. We give you all the honor and glory and the praise. In Jesus' precious and righteous name we pray. Amen. And our theme for this Good Friday, never get used to Calvary. And the message is going to be brought by our pastor, Jason Anderson. And scriptures will be coming from Matthew 27, verses 1 to 39. So we look forward to that. And at this time, I'm going to invite the praise and worship team to come and minister in song and praises.
Good morning, church.
Morning.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Always a joy, always a privilege to be in the house of God on a day like this to reflect on what Jesus Christ did for us so many years ago, not for any fault of his own, but to redeem us, to pay for our sins. The Bible says in 1 Peter 1, verses 18 through 19, "For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect." The songwriter puts it this way: we don't have to slay the lamb anymore. We don't have to place the blood on the door. Someone has taken the place of the lamb, and he is the great I am. Oh, it was precious blood. Praise God. Please join us and stand this morning. We're going to sing "The Blood That Jesus Shed For Me" way back on Calvary. Hallelujah. Will you stand with us if you can as we lift him up? Hallelujah.
The blood that Jesus shed.
For it reaches to the highest mountain.
For it reaches to the highest mountain. And it flows to the lowest valley. The blood that gives me strength.
Never lose its power. No matter where we are, it reaches to the highest mountain. It flows to the lowest valley. This blood, it was not just ordinary blood, the blood of the spotless lamb by which we are forgiven. Hallelujah. We are accepted even though he was condemned because he died and rose again. I'm forgiven, church. Hallelujah. Is that your testimony this morning? Hallelujah.
You died and
Go ahead, church. Go ahead and praise him.
Amen.
Go ahead and give him your praise.
Hallelujah.
Love kept him on that cross. Hallelujah. The blood still has power. Thank God the blood prevails. If you're not saved today, the blood still has power for the redemption of your sins. Hallelujah. That precious blood, hallelujah, still flows. Calvary. Thank God the blood prevails. Hallelujah.
Prevails. The blood prevails, the blood of the risen Lamb. forget what you've done for me. Jesus, I'll never forget how you've set me free. Jesus, I'll never forget how you've brought me out. Jesus, I'll never forget your name.
How can I forget?
How can I forget what you've done for me? How can I forget how you set me free? How can I forget how you brought me out? How can I forget your name?
I shall see glory be to God. Hallelujah. He set me free. And whom the Son sets free is truly free. Indeed. How can a king die for a people? Hallelujah. It ought to be the other way around, church. How can a king, and can it be that he should die? How can it be? Hallelujah. We continue our worship this morning with a hymn. And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Died he for me who causes pain? Hallelujah. What a love.
Who healed him to death pursued.
that amazing love, how can it be that though the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, should die for me, undeserving, while we were yet sinners? Hallelujah. Go ahead and sit. You may have a seat as our pastor comes with the official welcome.
This is a very, very special day of celebration. We can never find words to express our gratitude to God for what he has done in the giving of his son. And I suppose all the time spent in heaven, we'll never get used to giving him praise and honor for that. We thank God for the privilege of coming together to celebrate this day that has provided the basis for our hope for a glorious future with our God in heaven. Thank God for Jesus. And thank God that he wrapped human flesh around his eternal spirit, climbed down the stairway of heaven into our world of sin and shame, climbed up Golgotha's cruel hill, laid down his life on the cross for our sins, and light up our future with immortal hope. We thank God. And we welcome you to this service, and we trust that those truths will be reinforced and you'll leave here today with a greater, deeper love and commitment to Jesus Christ. Let us pray. We beg your Father in a very special way to cause your presence to be real and powerful, and give us the grace to embrace Jesus, his love with all our hearts, and to express that reality to those around us. We thank you for the privilege of celebrating the greatest event in human history. And we pray that you will help us, that by lip and life, we will demonstrate, exhibit our appreciation for what Christ has done for us. Pray that you'll make this day a blessing. And we ask again that you'll cause that our lives will be an unending thank you to Jesus, to God, for all he has done and been to us. We praise you, Lord. Let this day be a blessing in the name of Jesus for the glory of God. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Welcome you heartily. And we trust that, again, we will be refreshed through his word. Our vision and appreciation of Jesus Christ will be deepened. Our love and commitment to Christ will be exhibited, not just every Easter, but every moment of every day of our lives. Welcome to another service here at Havenhill. And I trust you'll leave here today refreshed and even more deeply committed to live for God, to serve your God. We welcome those who are with us online. Trust this will be a wonderful fellowship that you will remember and celebrate, not only here, but when we get to heaven, the celebration will continue. God bless you richly, and may you have a wonderful, meaningful Easter period. Thank you.
Thank you for that, Reverend Smith. And just a bit on the so we're going to have our scripture reading at this time. So I'm going to invite Sister Dion Lewis for the scripture reading. Our reading from Matthew 27, verses 1 to 39.
Good morning, everyone. Scripture reading is taken from Matthew 27, reading from verse 1 through to 39. I'll be reading from the New King James Version. I'll read while you follow. When morning came, all the chief priests and elders of the people plotted against Jesus to put him to death. And when they had bound him, they led him away and delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, his betrayer, seeing that he had been condemned, was remorseful and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, I have sinned by betraying innocent blood. And they said, what is that to us? You'll see to it. Then he threw down the pieces of silver in the temple and departed, and went and hanged himself. But the chief priests took the silver pieces and said, it is not lawful to put them into the treasury, because they are the price of blood. And they consulted together and bought with them the potter's field to bury strangers in. Therefore, that field has been called the field of blood to this day. Then was fulfilled what was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet, saying, and they took the 30 pieces of silver, the value of him who was priced, whom they of the children of Israel priced, and gave them for the potter's field, as the Lord directed me. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, saying, are you the king of the Jews? Jesus said to him, it is as you say. And while he was being accused by the chief priests and elders, he answered nothing. Then Pilate said to him, do you not hear how many things they testify against you? But he answered him not one word, so that the governor marveled greatly. Now at the feast, the governor was accustomed to release into the multitude one prisoner whom they wished. And at that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. Therefore, when they had gathered together, Pilate said to them, whom do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ? For he knew that they had handed him over because of envy. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent to him, saying, have nothing to do with that just man, for I have suffered many things today in a dream because of him. But the chief priests and elders persuaded the multitudes that they should ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor answered and said to them, which of the two do you want me to release to you? They said, Barabbas. Pilate said to them, what then shall I do with Jesus, who is called Christ? They all said to him, let him be crucified. Then the governor said, why, what evil has he done? But they cried out all the more, saying, let him be crucified. When Pilate saw that he could not prevail at all, but rather that a tumult was rising, he took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. You see to it. And all the people answered and said, his blood be on us and on our children. Then he released Barabbas to them. And when he had scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole garrison around him. And they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. When they had twisted a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and a reed in his right hand. And they bowed the knee before him and mocked him, saying, hail, King of the Jews. Then they spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they took the robe off him, put his own clothes on him, and led him away to be crucified. Now, as they came out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. Him they compelled to bear his cross. And when they had come to a place called Golgotha, that is to say, place of a skull, they gave him sour wine mingled with gall to drink. But when he had tasted it, he would not drink. Then they crucified him and divided his garments, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet. They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Sitting down, they kept watch over him there, and they put over his head the accusation written against him. "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and another on the left. And those who passed by blasphemed him, wagging their heads. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank my sister for the reading of the word, and we're going to go into a little time of reflections, we call it, testimonies about the cross, and I'm sure we can attest to that. We can testify about the cross, what it has done in our life, what it means to us, and we're going to just spend a few moments. And I'm going to ask the ushers to assist in the process. We have some mics up front. So you can just stand, raise your hand when you're ready to give a word of testimony. And in Hebrews, while we wait, Hebrews 9:22, "And almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without the shedding of blood is no remission of sin." Christ shed blood. With Christ shed blood, you know, we can enjoy this gift of salvation. And we know we have testimonies to share. Don't be shy. My sister.
What was the cross mean so much to me? It is the cross that set me free. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. Simple and true.
It was on that old rugged cross. Jesus bled and died for my sins. Praise be to God.
Amen, amen, amen. Amen. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Keep it going, keep it going.
Greater love hath no man than this, that a man laid down his life for his friend.
Whoa, amen, amen.
Morning, everybody. I'm just grateful to God that the veil was rent in twain at this time. That gave me access to a mighty God. All the wisdom, all the provisions, all the protection, we have access because of this day. Praise Jesus.
Amen. Amen. And we give thanks for the cleansing blood of Jesus. In 1 John 1, verse 7, "But if we walk in light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanseth us from all sin." My brother.
Cleansing blood, and thank him for today. This is the only day that none of us will ever live to see again. Thank God for the day.
Amen, amen, amen.
Jesus dying on the cross have given me life and hope.
Amen. Amen. Sister.
Good morning, everyone. This is the most significant day in my life, and I'm sure in other Christians' life. I would trade this day for nothing. It's a good day and it's a bad day, but the good thing about it is that we have been saved. Maybe bad because Jesus had to die on the cross to save us. Yes. So I just want to give him thanks for his sacrifice, for the Father's sacrifice, and I wouldn't trade this day for nothing.
Amen, amen. And we have been justified by his blood in Romans 5, verse 9. Much more then, be now justified by his blood. We shall be saved from wrath through him. And we look forward. And I'm just going to break it up a bit. Just, oh, one more.
Brother. Good morning, everyone. The cross is so significant. And you know, Jesus said to the dying thief, you will be with me in paradise. Mm-hmm. So probably he was one of those first persons who benefited from Jesus's sacrifice. And I want to therefore give God thanks for the cross.
Amen, amen, amen. I'm just going to ask the praise team, we're going to just intersperse some blessings in songs. And we're going to jump back in the testimony. So I'm going to ask the praise team to come.
When his wounded hands touch mine, church, please join us and stand if you can as we continue our worship this morning. Yes, he set us free through all eternity when his wounded hands touch mine.
When his wounded hands touch mine.
Many of us experienced that touch. How we came to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. So the floor is open again for some testimonies. Reflection. Take ourselves back to that time when Jesus was on his way to the cross. He didn't back away. He knew that he had to do it. And he went there just for us. Floor is open. Floor is open.
Thank you. Thank you for the shed blood on Calvary's cross, which cleanses me, so that today I can stand in your house, in your presence, to give you thanks and praise for all that you have done for me. Bless you.
Amen, amen, amen. Stop.
I just want to thank the Lord for paying the penalty for my sins. I should have been on that cross, and he took my place. How can I say thanks for all you have done for me? To God be the glory. Worthy old realm of nature mine, that was a tribute far too small. Love so amazing, so divine, demands my life, my soul, my all. Amen.
Amen, amen. Thank you for that, my sister. Keep it going. Let's keep it going. He has done so much for us.
He knew me
yet he loved me. When he was on the cross, I was on his mind. I'm so unworthy of such mercy. Yet, when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. Amen?
Amen, 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 amen.
Good morning, church. The Spirit of the Lord this morning is saying, the water is troubled. The water is troubled. There are angels stirring the water this morning. Gather yourselves. Gather your family members. Gather your loved ones. Gather your enemies in the name of Jesus to step into the water. There is spiritual water being stirred up this morning. Do not hesitate while you sit in your seats. Gather your children. Gather your co-workers. Gather our politicians. Gather the folks around us that we see walking by us every day, that we let them pass and we don't give them a word. Gather them this morning. That's what he wants us to do. Not sit and be pretty. Gather his people, because the water is being stirred up this morning in the name of Jesus.
Amen, amen. You know, believers, Jesus did a wonderful work. I mean, we are bursting with spiritual energy because what he had done on the cross. Just imagine, we who know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, we can look forward to the blessed hope when he will return and redeem us. Treasures, heavenly treasures. My sister.
Morning, church. I thank the Lord Jesus for the cross, because without him I would still be lost. So I have everything to give thanks, and I praise him for enduring so that we could have the victory. Thank you, Jesus, for the cross.
Amen, amen. I'll take a few more. Sister.
Good morning, church.
Good morning, church.
Morning.
Because he lives, a sinner like me can face tomorrow.
Amen, amen.
He died on Calvary to take away not just my sins, but the sins of the world, so that on that day we can be presented faultless before the throne of God.
Amen, amen, amen. We have righteousness through Christ in 2 Corinthians 5:21. For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. We have righteousness through Christ, not our own self-righteousness, but true righteousness has been imputed. That's why we can look forward. And while we were sinners, in Romans 5, verse 8, but God commended his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Amazing. We sang that song earlier, amazing love. And that's what his love is about. Even on the cross, Luke 23:34. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they parted his raiment and cast lot. Those who killed him were forgiven. That was wiped. You can imagine that? They crucified Christ for that. No one paid any price for that. None. Because he said, Father, forgive them.
So that sin, that act of taking Jesus to the cross, nailing him, pushing, spearing him side, spitting, all of that. The loving God that we worship, forgive. Forgive all of that. What a God. What a God. A God of forgiveness. God of forgiveness. Why did he go to the cross? I don't want to interrupt Pastor Jason's message, but why did he go to the cross? I will go back, jump in John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's why I said Jesus went through all that just for us. Testify, God has been good to us. This world squeezing us, squeezing out our testimonies. But we serve a God, we serve a loving God, we serve a good God. He'll never leave us, he'll never forsake us. He will always be there for us. He loves us, he has a good plan. Let us not forget that. Any more testimonies? Brother.
Good morning. Destined to hell. Mm. But thank God for Jesus Christ and his humility even to death. The perfect sacrifice for my sin. Thank God for what he did for me. He conquered sin, death, and the grave. And because of that this morning, I know he's alive. And I got thanks that I serve a living and a true God. Bless his holy name.
Amen, 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 amen. My brother. Oh, sister.
All to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain. He washes white as snow. These are my few words. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you, sister.
Good morning, church. For me, the cross means freedom. I walk one day along the country road, and there a stranger journeyed through. Bent low beneath the burden of his care, it was a cross I knew. Take up your cross and follow me. I heard the blessed Savior say, how can I make a lesser sacrifice when Jesus gave his own? Amen.
Amen, amen. Hey, I tell you, the Spirit is with us this morning. Take
good
up
morning,
my cross. So my next thing was, what do we do? And that comes from Luke 9:23, as the sister said. And he said to them all, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross. When? How often? Daily. Take up the cross daily and follow me. Just as the song my sister was singing right there. What if we do not take up the cross? Matthew 10:38. And he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. Amen. My sister.
Good morning, church. My dear sweet Jesus sacrificed his life for me. Good morning, church.
Morning.
My dear sweet Jesus sacrificed his life for me on the cross. I know I can depend on him, hope with hope all the days of my life.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. 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 Thank you for that, sis.
I too just want to say how much I love Jesus. He has done everything. There is not one claim that could have been made against him. Even when he got a reprieve to drink,
yes,
as was read, just to drink so that it could alleviate some of the pain. Him said, no, I'm going all the way.
Yes.
Then for this, mankind should know him. And it's a shame that people die and go to hell.
Yes.
Having everything already done for them. And Satan every day scam people out of the benefits of being linked to Jesus Christ. As the sister said, let us take up our cross too and follow him.
Amen, amen, amen. And before we invite the praise team back, just one more note. My sister, go before.
Good morning, church. You know, I am baffled and amazed because he knew what was before him.
Yes.
And he didn't back away. He went faithfully just for us. Now I ask us, if we were faced with that same situation, would we be willing to go? I know I would not. He has to be God. The little things that he asked us to do, we back away from. And look at what he has done for us.
Right.
We need to do more.
Mm-hmm.
The things that are asked of us, we need to say yes.
Yes.
Yes, because he said yes. And because of his yes, we are here today. We have hope, everlasting hope.
Yes.
Thank you.
Amen, amen. Thank you for that, sister. And we're going to close off this testimony session. I'm going to invite the praise team to come back. But what do we do? What do we do? And we jump into Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20. And this is Jesus departing. Go ye, therefore, and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. We have a responsibility, not just to take our salvation and sit on it, but to follow our Lord's command and make that news be known in our homes, in our communities, in this land we love and in the world. Bless you all. Praise team.
When I think of the goodness of Jesus and what he has done for me, my soul cries out, hallelujah. Thank God for saving me. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You may stand with us, church, if you can, as we continue our worship this morning.
We're going to move into our time of offering. So I'm going to just ask the gentleman to come forward. We're going to take our offering at this time. Just ask the ushers. Let's ask Brother Mark to bless the offering.
Let us pray. Eternal God, O Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace and mercy that has brought us here today. We thank you, O Lord, for your presence here with us today. We pray, O God, that you will so fill us today with your Holy Spirit. Open our hearts and our minds to your word as we reflect on what you did for us in Calvary and the charge that you have given us to go forth and share the good news as believers. We pray for those today in the service that don't know you. I pray, God, that you will meet each and every one of them today, wherever they are. Meet with them right now, Almighty God. And I pray that you'll give them a heart of flesh to be receptive to your word. And I pray today will be the day that they be delivered from sin, death, and the grave. Deliverance has come, and they will take advantage of that today. Almighty God, we come now at a time as we seek to give back a portion of that which you have blessed us with. We ask your blessing on it, Almighty God. Multiply it, O God, for your use here on earth. We give you thanks in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Wow. Thank you for that, Brother Mark. And we're gonna go into our second hymn while we collect the morning's offering. After which the combined choir will minister to us in song. So, praise team.
Gonna take the song above all kingdoms, above all things, above all created things. He was crucified. Not for anything that he had done, not for any sin of his own. He was spotless. He was without blemish. And yet he went to the cross for you and for me. Above all powers, all kings, he could have come down. He could have defended himself. He is omnipotent. But love kept him on that cross for you and I, for the redemption of our souls. Hallelujah. Above all powers, join us, please, and stand. Above all kings, all nature, all created things, yet they crucified him. Hallelujah.
Above all powers, above all. Here before the world.
That kept him there. Hallelujah. He could have come down. He could have defended himself. He was accused and he was guiltless, and yet he went. Hallelujah. The Bible tells us that in the garden he prayed until his blood became, until his sweat became as blood. Hallelujah. It was love, his love for us. It was, he was not powerless. Oh, they mocked him. Yes, they scorned him. They spat on him. They said, you said you would build a temple. You said you would tear it down and build it up in 3 days. Come down and save yourself. But he stood the course. He went all the way. Hallelujah. And died a cruel death, even though he was blameless. Hallelujah. But our church, Sunday morning is coming. Hallelujah. The death could not hold him. The grave could not defeat him. He arose. Hallelujah. For you and for me, for the redemption of our sins. But oh, we love him for what he did on that cross, on the old rugged cross. And so we will always sing. We will always celebrate. Please be seated as we receive the ministry of the combined choir singing. I will always sing of the cross. Hallelujah.
Yeah, thank you to the choir. Let's give them another round of applause. Let's bless them as they continue to sacrifice their time to attend to God's work. And we're at that point of the message. And just to remind us, message coming from Pastor Jason Anderson this morning, never get used to Calvary. And we look forward to what God has laid on his heart. So without further ado, invite Pastor Jason.
Morning, everyone. Always good to be together in God's house. I was reminded here, we were reminded, Sister Etta, I think that's what the handwriting is. Sister Etta Hamilton, I can't make out the handwriting, is in church today. Is that right, Sister Etta Hamilton? She used to sit right where Brother Merrick Ennis would sit, but she has changed her position. It's very good to see her. It's been a rough 6 months or so for her. Fell down, hit her head, was in ICU, had to learn how to walk again. Here she is in church today. To God be the glory. We're not going to ask her to stand up so that you can see who she is, to put her under the pressure, but it's very, very nice to see you, Sister Etta, and your family with her today. Her granddaughter with her here today. Thank you for coming out today as well and to facilitate her being here. And it's good to have everyone else here. And if you're here for the first time, we welcome you to Havenhill Baptist Church, whether you're here or in the auditorium, and trust that you have been blessed so far. And it's very clear, this is icing on the cake because of all the different songs that we have sung, which is biblical. And we've heard the scripture reading from Sister Dion, and we just heard the choir song. We heard all the testimonies and the things that were shared. So we have gotten a lot of messages today about the significance of this day and this time. And I want to just share a little reflection with us today about the significant day that we're celebrating, and with this title, Never Get Used to Calvary. Never get used to Calvary. Let's pray before we get into our thoughts here for today. Lord, thank you so much for what this day means to every single one of us. This is why we get up and come out to the worship service. This is why we have reasons to rejoice. This is why we can smile in the storm, because of what the cross means to us, to our lives, and for our future. And we pray, Lord, that you will just finish the work that you have begun through the service today, and that we will be inspired, challenged, encouraged to give you our allegiance, to follow you, as our sister sung earlier, take up our cross daily to follow you, because you are worthy when we think of all that you have done for us. So let your Holy Spirit complete the work he has begun in our lives, in our hearts. Now we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Never get used to Calvary. Interestingly, research shows that most accidents happen when people are closest to home. I was looking at this website. Well, it's a law firm, but they are utilizing the data to try to get persons to buy into their product. In 2017, the study was published in the Journal of Safety and Science, concluded that the close-to-home effect holds for male and female drivers of all ages. So it's not discriminating between women or men who will have accidents when they're closest to home. So they're trying to figure out why these things happen. A likely reason is that the driver takes more risks, is that they are in a familiar territory, since they know the turns and landmarks. They may even feel as if they can reduce their attention and put less effort into driving. Another thing he says here is, while under the influence of alcohol, sometimes people may do these things. And then the thing about muscle memory, relying on muscle memory to just repeat driving motions, you know, going through the motions, we know this already, needed to get through the last mile of the trip. And finally, he says here further, drivers are more likely to succumb to distractions or to make risky driving decisions in their neighborhood roads compared to if they're on the highway and have to pay more closer attention to the way. Bottom line is that when things are familiar to us in driving world, you're likely to have more accidents, make more mistakes, and take things for granted. And nothing is further from the truth. This can be compared to this story that we listen to every single year. We look forward to it. We build the church services and the messages around it and flyers and everything. And so we know the story. We've heard it many times before. We've been in Sunday school. And let's be honest here. I really was wrestling. Just think about this. Talk about getting used to Calvary. Wrestling with the scripture reading. And just the reactions to scripture reading. Well, why is the scripture reading so long? And let's be honest. How many of us in our hearts, you don't have to show any hands, felt a bit uneasy with the length of the reading? Or if we had seen it before, 39 verses? Or we may even be rolling our eyes in our head. Just think about that. This is about the very reason we're here today. And in my heart, it's like I was questioning myself as to whether or not I should have this reading. And I started to ask myself, well, what is your problem? Why are you even apologizing? I'm saying this to myself, for having the reading. This is the reason why we are celebrating the season. How is it going to hurt us to hear about the most significant event of our lives? And that's the kind of thing that hit me to say, you know what? We really can get to that place where we just take God's message for granted. We can take what Jesus has done for granted. So much so that I can't even bother. I don't even want to spend the length of time to read his word about it. Just give me the digest version. We don't want things to become familiar and so forth. So today, I'm just going to share with us 6 quick advice. This is more of a reflection for us to not take Calvary for granted, to never get used to Calvary. Never get used to Calvary. The first I'm going to share with us today is that we need to read these highly selective stories, like the one we read this morning, over and over, especially outside of the Passover. I'm not going to say Easter, Passover season, because that's when it happened, in the Passover season, and Jesus is our Passover. So I'm saying we need to read, be intentional about reading these stories about Jesus. And I say highly selective stories, right? Let's take a look at what Luke chapter 1, verses 1 to 4 says. Luke chapter 1, verses 1 to 4, very, very instructive. He says here, inasmuch as he's writing to Theophilus, and we're talking about highly selective, meaning there are many other things that the writer could have said. I want to make sure I know the time. That watch, that clock is misleading. All right? It says, inasmuch as many have undertaken in hand to set in order a narrative of those things which have happened, which have been fulfilled among us. So he's saying many people have done it before, just as those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses. We're talking about the people who are around Jesus, and Matthew is one of them, and ministers of the word delivered them or handed them down to us, whether it is in written form or in verbal form, right? So there was some pre-existing information about these stories. And Luke is saying, since other people have done that, it seems good to me also, as a writer, Luke, having had perfect understanding of all things from the very first, what is he doing? To what? To write to you an orderly account, most excellent Theophilus. And verse 4, why is he writing these things? So that what? You may know the certainty of those things in which you were instructed. If we are going to get to that place where we never get used to Calvary, it's not a less is more principle for us. It's the more of Jesus we can get immersed into, so we can get wrapped up, tied up, tangled up in Jesus, the more we can immerse ourselves in the horror, as our brother Hekima was spelling out this morning, of what he went through, it's the more we are able to appreciate these things that he has done for us and never get to that place where we take it for granted. Even so much where I would want to be apologizing for reading about it in the season and in the moment and in the place where it should be done. How ridiculous is that? One of the reading here, we talk about selective. It is very important what we say, selective, highly selective. In John chapter 20, verse 25, again, another gospel talking about the things that are written here for us and why it's very important to do that. John 21, verse 25 says that Jesus did, and there are also many other things that Jesus did, which if they were written, see the less selectivity, there are many other things that the story that we read today that could have been said. But he says, which if they were written one by one, I suppose that even the world itself, what? Could not contain the books that would have been written. So what is here in the text is very intentional by the writer, because he has something that he wants to communicate to us in a very special way. And that is very, very important to us. So the last thing I'll say on this here is the structure of this section is very important to communicate to us that if we are going to get past getting used to Calvary, because we know the story from Sunday school, we hear it read when we're growing up, and we're here again. If we're going to get past that, where it's fresh to us all the time, even the structure of the text is instructive to this. There's 125 verses. I thought about reading all of them, just for the fun of it, right? Because it is the story. And the Jewish people, listening to their story, stood for half the day listening to Moses. Very reverent about it. That is really where we got standing up for the word of God, the reading. 125 verses. To talk about the structure is instructive from this selective text, why we have to read it over and over and over, especially outside of this season. The 125, out of the 125, and our sister stood up and shared about the turmoil, 29 of those verses focus on the weight, the inner turmoil that Jesus went through. 29 of those 125 verses, that's 23%, of his suffering, which is instructive, very instructive here, 56 of those 125 verses focused on the actual suffering that Jesus went through. Just think about that. 44%. And this is prior to the cross. Almost 70% of 80% of the time that the gospel writer dedicated in his writing is focused on leading up to Jesus' suffering on the cross. Just think about that. And as it relates to his cross, being on the cross, only 11 verses of the 125 verses is dedicated to that. Not that it's less significant, but if you think about the writer's perspective and how much time he gave to what, it's giving us a message that we need to ensure that these things will not slip us. And when we do that, that is where we can get to the place and take one of those steps towards not getting used to Calvary. It's just another story. Yeah, we know the story. We know the end. We know it's going to end. And that's very, very important for us to keep in mind. The inner turmoil, the weight of the cup, his sufferings, and of course, his crucifixion. Bottom line is, brothers and sisters, if we want to get to that place, to not get used to Calvary, not get used to what Jesus went through, we have to immerse ourselves over and over into the story. These highly selective stories. Not by chance anything is there for us. It says there in Second Timothy that all scripture is inspired by God and profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for training, for instructions in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped unto every good work. And these scriptures are there to help us do just that, to focus on just that. The second reason here, we want to ensure, the second advice I'm offering here, is for us to facilitate and partake of the Lord's Supper as often as possible. Now, note Matthew chapter 26, verses 26 to 29. Matthew 26, 26 to 29. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said to them, "Take, eat, this is my body." Next verse. Then he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you." Verse 28, "For this is what? My blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many." Why? For the remission, for the forgiveness of sins. And verse 29, "But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's house." And then we know Paul said, "I offer to you in 1 Corinthians 11 what I have received from the Lord." What did he say to him? On the night he was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. And he says what? Take, 1 Corinthians 11, verse 23 to 26. "Take, eat, this is my body, which is for you." What should we do? Do this, not just remembrance. Do this as often in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do what? Show, announce, ring out the Lord's death. See that? The Lord's death until he comes. For as often as we what? Eat this bread and drink this cup. And we know Jesus was weighed down with the cup. "If this is possible, Lord, let this cup pass from me." So that cup, play on the word, as often as you eat and drink, you are proclaiming, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes. So when I say the second advice I would share with us to help us to not get to the place where we get used to this story, is to facilitate, that is more on a church side, as often as we can facilitate communion, we should. And partake, as often as we, as believers, can participate in it, we should. We should not think, "I am going to skip out on communion today." When up to the point of the communion, we have the opportunity to ask God's cleansing and forgiveness. We have the opportunity to ask God to forgive us, to forgive people. Whatever it is that will be hindering us from participating in communion, we can talk to the Lord about it in that moment. We should never get to the place where we don't want to put ourselves in the best position to take communion. And if we are not in that place, one step at a time, before we know it, the story of Calvary just becomes another story to us. So one of the ways to remember Jesus and what Jesus has done for us and what he went through, this horrible death, is to facilitate and to participate in Holy Communion as often as possible. So the more we are engaged in this, this is not the economy rule, the law of diminishing return. With the more we have it, we're gonna appreciate it less. How can we have more of Jesus and appreciate Jesus less? Think about that, if that makes sense. How can we take the blood of Jesus for granted if we are reminded of Jesus' blood and his death every single time? The more of that we have, the more exposure we have, the more we get involved in these things, it's going to help us to appreciate what he has done. It's going to break us. Because as was said in one of the testimonies, we were supposed to be on that cross. And he died in our place. And every time we participate in the Lord's table, we are reminded of that. And we are inspired to go out and live our lives to his glory. Amen? So number one, steps or advice towards not taking the Lord's, not taking Calvary for granted, not getting used to it, is we got to read the stories over and over, even outside of the season. Number two, we got to facilitate and participate in the Lord's table as often as possible, as much as it depends on us to do that. Number three, we need to, and Brother Hekima said this as well, allow ourselves to feel and to enter into his aloneness, the aloneness of his experience. Everything that Jesus experienced, brothers and sisters, was alone. He was alone. Every single thing. We're trying to enter into that. What was it like? Think about a parent who says, this happened to my child or this happened to my family member. And every time you listen to them speak, in reflection, I just imagine what they were going through all that time, how scared they might have been, how distressed they might have been, not having anyone there to help them or to rescue them. You can hear the anguish in the parents' voice when they're talking about a missing child or someone who was murdered. What was it like for them in those last moments? They're trying to enter into that, to try to feel what that child must have been feeling, crying out for help with no one to rescue. And we're trying to do the same thing when we think about the things with Jesus, his aloneness. And I like Scott Peck, who said, aloneness is the unavailability of people to communicate or connect with at your level of awareness. So you're there with people, but nobody can relate to or identify what you're experiencing. Here's an example here. The weight of the cup, chapter 26, verse 1 and 2, says, now it came to pass when Jesus had finished all these sayings that he said to his disciples, remember the weight of the cup. We're trying to enter into what he felt. You know that after 2 days in the Passover, the Son of Man, Jesus is the only person who refers to himself as the Son of Man, in identification with what was said in Daniel chapter 7. After 2 days, the Son of Man will be delivered up to be crucified. Another person shared about the fact that he knew ahead of time what was going to happen to him, and yet he went all the way for us. Look at again in verse 11. He was very much aware of the cup. He was very much aware. Verse 11 says, For she has done a good work for me, talking about the lady who anointed him, for you have the poor with you always, but for me you do not you will not always have. For in pouring this fragrant oil on my body, he did it for what? He did it for my burial. He did it for my burial. Talking about the weight of the cup. We're staying there. Verse 18, same chapter. And he said, go into the city to a certain man and say to him, the teacher says, this is talking about the Passover. He is our Passover. My time is what? At hand. My time is at hand. I will keep the Passover. Not only keep it, but he is the Passover. That's very interesting. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples. Stay in that same chapter there. We're talking about the weight that he felt, and it's just Jesus feeling this weight. Verse 28, but I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from no one until the day I drink it new with you in my Father's house. Because he knew he's about to die. Because his blood is going to be poured out for this moment. And verse 36 says, this is the weight of the cup on Jesus Christ. He came to them, came with them to the place called Gethsemane. And he said to them, remember we're talking about trying to enter into his aloneness. Everything he was going through, it was alone. And not saying he was lonely. He had people around him. That's not what we're talking about. He was alone, not having anybody in his space that could identify with and connect to his level of awareness, what he was experiencing, even the people closest to him. Sit here while I go and what? Pray over there. Very simple instruction. Verse 37. And he took with him, again, we're learning the disciples' name. Look who is going together. Peter, James, and John, right? The two sons of Zebedee. And he began to be what? Sorrowful and deeply distressed. Why? The weight of the cup. So from Matthew's standpoint, the tax collector Levi here writing, he's telling us what Jesus was experiencing. He was experiencing what? Sorrow and what? And what? Deep distress. Verse 38, this is aloneness we're talking about. Then he said to them, my soul is what? Exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. My soul, not our souls. My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death. Stay here and watch. Watch with me. Watch with me. Verse 39. He went a little farther, fell on his face, and prayed, saying, oh, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not what I want or will, but as you will. And what was the next verse? What does the next verse tell us? He's going through these things alone. Then he came to the disciples and found them what? Found them sleeping. He said to Peter, what could you, the you there is not singular, by the way, it's not just to Peter. He's speaking to the three of them. Could you not watch with me? Could you not identify with my aloneness for 1 hour? We know what the answer is. And he did it again, and he came back. And what were they doing? Sleeping. And he did it again, and he prayed the same thing the third time, and he came back. And what were they doing? Sleeping. So it ends there in verse 47. It says here, verse 45, are you still sleeping? What was the answer? And resting? Yes, they were. Behold, the hour, the weight, is at hand. And the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand. And the exact opposite of having that person in the space of his aloneness, verse 47, is crazy. And while he was still speaking, behold, Judas, and what's the statement after Judas? One of the 12. Can you imagine? With a great multitude with swords and clubs came from the chief priests and the elders of the people. If we are going to get to that place, brothers and sisters, where we don't get used to this, we have to try to enter into what he felt, the aloneness of that experience as he was going through everything. Other things you can consider here, we heard his prayers. We talk about his betrayal, his prayers for deliverance. Let this pass from me, nevertheless, not what I want, what you want. We talk about here the unjust interrogations that he went through in the dark without any representation. We talk about the rejection from the Jewish leaders and from the people. Crucify him! Crucify him! We want who in return? Give us a murderer. Give us Barabbas. A murderer. He's a murderer. Convicted murderer. We want him instead of Jesus. But with Jesus, crucify him. Crucify him. We have no king but Caesar. Hey, okay. I wash my hands from this. Hey, his blood be upon us and our children. Wow. So the people he came to save disassociated themselves from Jesus. Jesus is alone, not having anybody among his disciples, among the other people, among the nation that can identify with him, that can connect with him at his level of awareness. He is doing this alone. And for us to be able to get to that place where we never get used to this kind of story, where it's just another Easter and the longest readings in the Bible, we have to seek to identify, to enter into what Jesus was experiencing in that aloneness experience throughout that 24 hours, that last 24 hours, from Thursday evening till the afternoon of Friday, 3 o'clock when he's on the cross and he says, it is finished. What was it like for him when the disciple was being engaged? Hey, your accent, it sounds familiar. I don't know the man. He called up a curse, swore upon himself. I don't know the man. His disciples, when they grabbed Jesus, every one of them fled. He was alone. That is a big thing. If we can try to enter, to feel his pain, that will certainly help us to not get used to this story. Not to mention, if you watch this visually, they're very good at putting these things to motion picture. Make it ball. But we don't want to get used to it. Can you know why? If we get used to this, then we can live our lives anyway. As our sister said when she was sharing, which I think she held herself back from crying, we can do more. We can do much more. When we think about, when we try to enter into what Jesus did for us, we realize that we're not saying anything. There's so much more we can do. I went to play basketball this morning. I'd love to do that early morning because nobody's awake, not troubling anybody. And I'm playing with all those guys, basketball. And you know what? I didn't tell them about Jesus. I didn't even tell them about anything that I was going to preach. I'm just playing basketball. I mean, I know they call me past and all these other things. And I really behave differently with them. But that's not sufficient. I missed out. I did not do the more. And I could have and I should have. They were not apologizing for their behavior and what they stand for because I heard them. But I was just on my best behavior. That's not good enough. I was church to them. But you know what? I didn't sing any songs. I didn't read any scripture. And I didn't preach any message. But you know what? They just came, the door was closed, and I went back. I could do so much more with that. Spent an hour and a half with those guys, missed out on that. But if I get used to this, that's what will happen. But if I never get used to this, I'm going to do more. And every opportunity I get, I'm going to maximize it. Because I realize what Jesus did for me and how much it meant and what it cost him. And I can't do any less but to try to demonstrate my great gratitude for that. So just these things to keep in mind. Allow ourselves to feel or to enter into the aloneness of his experience. Not to mention the desertion, the disowning, and of course the cross. The fourth advice we want to share with us here is to volunteer to take up your cross daily. We heard it sung in the song from our sister's audition for the choir this morning. Volunteer to take up your cross daily and follow Jesus all the way. Why do I say volunteer? Look at verse 27 again of chapter 26. Very instructive. It says there in verse 37, while Jesus was carrying it, it says there verse 27 of 27. All right, verse, you're with me? It says here, so he's carrying his cross here, brothers and sisters. They forced Simon to verse 37. Now, as they came out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. Him they compelled to do what? Bear his cross. They forced him to carry Jesus' cross. But my advice for us today, if we feel forced, if we feel like we're just doing this out of a routine in following Jesus, then certainly we're going to get used to Calvary. But if we volunteer, again, when we consider everything he did for us, we are volunteering self. If any man wishes to what? Come after me. Let him do what? Deny himself. Take up his cross. How often? Daily. And follow me. We don't have to wait for anybody to preach a message to guilt trip us. We don't have to have anybody remind us the reason why we should be serving God and giving him our best. Because we just think about everything, we read about everything, we try to enter into these things that he did for us. We immerse ourselves into these things so we can appreciate these things. So that when we live our lives, brothers and sisters, it is out of a heart of gratitude and thanks. We would not need anybody to motivate us to serve God and to give him our best because he deserves it. Simply because that's what he did for us. And in this case, this is our reasonable service. So we need to volunteer. Not like Simon who was forced, but volunteer. Looking at what Jesus has done for us and run to him. Because as Sister Warren said, we deserve to be on that cross. But he did it willingly when they were cutting off the people's ears. He says, stop. Must I not drink the cup? How else will the scripture be fulfilled? Not what I want, but what you want. He was thinking about all of us. That is the reason why we get up and run to Jesus. And that is the reason why we spend the rest of our lives living for him. Because of what he willingly did for us. So we don't have to be doing it by force, dragging our feet. We can serve him with excitement. With absolute excitement. Number five, just to repeat, number one, six advice on how not to get used to Calvary. We got to read the highest literature story over and over and over again. especially outside of this season. Number two, we need to facilitate and partake of the Lord's Supper, of the Holy Communion, as often as possible. Number three, we need to allow ourselves to feel or to enter into the aloneness of his experience. Number four, we just said we need to volunteer to take up our cross daily and follow Jesus all the way. Unlike Simon that was forced, we need to do it willingly. Number five, we need to stand up for Jesus when confronted with being associated with him. When the disciples in verse 56b of chapter 26 saw what happened to Jesus, the Bible says they all fled, every single one of them. The disciples forsook, I like that word, New King James here, they forsook him and fled, which emphasizes his aloneness. And then we see later on there in verse 58, what was Peter doing? Peter was following him, but how? From a distance. And sometimes that's how we serve Jesus. We don't even want to pray in public or bring our Bibles or wear anything that may point to the fact that we're religious and we have a relationship with Jesus. Following him from a distance. We're not standing up. We hear people having discussions in the lunchroom about Jesus and misrepresenting Christianity and all these things, and we say nothing. This opportunity may come for us to pray in our office because of a disaster. That is our moment. But we don't want people to think that we're this weirdo. People are going through difficulties and crises in their lives. We have an opportunity to step up, and we don't. We are not taking a stand for who we represent or to be who we are associated with. And we see it here. When Peter was asked three times, "But you know the man, you were with him." Three times Peter said, "I don't know the man." When the people were asked, "Hey, Pilate wanted to release Jesus. He really wanted to. Why? What has he done? He's innocent." All right? Hey, here's the opportunity. Every year, there's this custom. I can get away, give a prisoner away. Do you want me to give you Jesus? No. Give us Barabbas. They don't want to be associated with Jesus. We can't afford that kind of a stance. If we do that each time, we're moving closer and closer to getting used to what Jesus accomplished on Calvary. 2 Timothy 1, verses 11 and 12. The last scripture I'll share on this one here. And we close out with the last point. 2 Timothy 1. This is Paul. He's in prison. 2 Timothy. To this gospel, he says, I was what? Appointed a what? A preacher. And all of us are appointed as herald of the gospel, you know, or a witness. An apostle and a what? Teacher to the Gentile. But the next verse he says, why? Verse 12. But for this reason I also what? He's not ashamed to be associated with. He's not ashamed to stand up for Jesus Christ. And for that reason he's what? Suffering these things. He's in jail. Nevertheless, what he says? I am not ashamed. For I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is what? Able to keep that what keep what I have committed to him on that day. That verse can be actually read two ways. He is able to keep what I have committed to them, to him on that day. Can be read either way, right? But he's not ashamed. He's not ashamed to stand up for Jesus Christ. I am not ashamed of the gospel, he says, of Christ. Why? It is the power of God to salvation to anyone who believes, to the Jews first, and also to the Greeks. If we want to get past that place where it's just another Easter, we have to firstly read these highly selective stories over and over, especially outside of this season. Number two, we gotta facilitate and partake of Holy Communion. How often? As often as possible. Number three, we got to try to enter into, to feel the aloneness of his experience, what he went through. Number four, we need to volunteer to take up our cross daily and follow Jesus all the way. Number five, we just said we need to stand up for Jesus when confronted with being associated with him. We don't want to be like Peter. We don't want to be like the crowd. We want to be like Jesus himself, who willingly gave his life, went through that horrible death for us. The one last thing I want to mention here, which is very instructive here with Jesus. He's innocent. He's innocent. Verse 67 and 68. These are the things that could help us to see how much he went through for us. They spat in his face after condemning him, deserving of death. They beat him. And others, what? Struck him with the palm of their hands, saying, "Prophesy to us, Christ, who is the one who struck you?" Wow. Prophesy to us. Verse 26 of chapter 27 says, after the release of Barabbas, they scourged Jesus. Innocent person, he was whipped. You watch the Passion of the Christ, you see the seriousness of that. Verse 27, then the soldiers, I want us to think about this as we consider the last part here, maintain an attitude or a posture of gratitude. Romans says it best, "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the what? Mercies, plural, not getting what we deserve." This is what we deserve. What Jesus is experiencing here, this is what every single one of us deserve. We deserve to be on that cross. We deserve all the beating that he got, the battering, the abuse. We deserve that. But he did it for us. He did this for us. The last part here says, the soldiers, wow. The soldiers here in verse 60, in verse 26. Of chapter 27. So 27 verse, the soldiers of the governor took Jesus in the praetorium and gathered the whole garrison around him. This ought to make us just cry. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. Mockery here. When they had twisted a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and a reed at his right hand. And they bowed the knee before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" How ironic. Then they spat on him and took the reed, which is a wooden staff, and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they took the robe off him and put his own clothes on him and led him away to be crucified. And in verse 35, and when they crucified him, they divided his garment, casting lots, no remorse. And while he's on the cross, people are passing by, they're swearing, they're saying all kind of negative things. Talk about kicking a person when they're down. That's what they're doing. He said, "I could call on angels to rescue me." But he went through all of that for us. Brothers and sisters, if we are going to get past that place where we get used to this time. We'll get used to Calvary. If we want to never get to that place, the last advice here is to maintain an attitude or a posture of gratitude. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that we what? Romans 12, verse 1, that we what? That we present our bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is our what? Our reasonable service. That's the very least we can do. And what's the motivation for that? Well, we consider everything that Jesus went through, that horrible experience. This is the least we can do. Taking up our cross daily and doing this for the rest of our lives. I can't think of any. What's the closing song that we have? Wonderful, merciful Savior. He is wonderful, isn't he? He is merciful. We invite the praise team to come. I just ask, do you think that God will allow Jesus Christ to go through all of this? If you're here, you're not saved. Would God allow Jesus Christ to go through all of this? Endure all the suffering just so that it can be business as usual in our lives without a consequence? Think about that. Would God allow his son that he loves to go through all of this just so that I can live my life the way I want it? And it is all right. What about us as Christians? Is he going to allow us to just do that? The least we can do, brothers and sisters, is to offer ourselves back to him as a living sacrifice. He sacrificed himself for us, and we are to do the same for him. Step out today. Take a step and take a stand for Jesus today. You know, as I think about those guys I was with this morning, I could have told them about Jesus. Missed opportunity there. I maybe want to do that. Maybe it's not all these points that may relate to us. Maybe just one. We really want to take a step for Jesus Christ today. If you don't know Jesus Christ, you're taking Calvary for granted. You need to step out and surrender your life to him. He's a wonderful, merciful Savior. If you know Jesus, and it was just been another Easter season, we want to change that mindset to let Jesus become the center of our lives, not just in the season, but for every single day of our lives. Father, help us to embrace everything that you have done for us and to willingly present ourselves as a sacrifice, as a thank you offering, spending the rest of our lives saying, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Wonderful, merciful Savior. Let's stand as we sing. God is talking to you today. Take a stand for me. I've never given your life to Jesus Christ. Take a stand today. Come out and give your life to him.
Wonderful, merciful Savior.
Baby.
Precious Redeemer.
We know Jesus.
And friend.
We love Jesus.
Who would have
but we have identified, as our sister shared, that we can do more.
Rescue the
we can say yes things he's asking us to do.
Oh,
you can step out and say, Lord, here am I. Use me.
Counselor, comforter, keeper, spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when lost our way. Oh, we've hopeless.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Give God the highest praise.
Hallelujah. Praise God.
Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him, praise Him.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
That wonderful work done on the cross, just because He loves us. He loves us. I'm going to ask our brother Lennox Dean to close off for us. Brother Lennox.
Let us pray. Almighty God, how can we thank you enough that you saw us wretched, miserable, undeserved, the best of us, Lord, so undeserving, and yet you reached out to us. Lord, we are grateful that you left the splendor of heaven to come to save us. And Lord, for everyone that has accepted the call, Lord, how can we say thanks? Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the reminder, Lord, that it is really all about you, what you have done for us. And Lord, as I said in the message, we can just see this as another season. Another season of Lent, of Passover, of Holy Week, of Good Friday. But Lord, I pray that we will live this time in our hearts as we identify with the call for mercy and the thanks for grace. Because where would we be? Lord, we give you thanks for this day. We give you thanks for the world. We give you thanks for the privilege of coming under the preaching of the precious word. And Lord, we pray that we'll reflect today, this week, we'll reflect every day on the blessing that has been bestowed on us. That you did not give us what we deserve. And Lord, those of us who have accepted you as Lord and Savior, we can say thanks, but Lord, we need to share that word with others who are lost, with others who are on the way to hell. And Lord, if there's anyone here this morning who haven't taken part in this service, whether inside the auditorium or online. And you might say that this has been, you know, a good service, the word. But Lord, we reflect on our lives and understand that the things that we might have as priority are really not important. It is really all about serving you, about living, Lord, for you. So today, those who have heard your voice, we pray that we will not harden our hearts, but Lord, we'll respond and say yes. And to the many who have accepted you, but Lord, living far from you, we pray that this season we'll seek to honor you with our lives. We just want to give you all the thanks. We want to give you all the glory. And we want to give you all the praise. In Jesus' name.
Amen. So, just wishing you a good rest of the Good Friday. God bless and keep you. And we are here back again on Sunday morning, Resurrection Sunday. So we pray that you'll join us again. And, you know, we spoke about the word going out into the highways and the byways. You can join us on Saturday evening at 4 o'clock where we go out into the communities to spread the good news. Okay? God bless you. God keep you. God go with you.
Loose. redemption waits our chains to break.
He comes in glory to reign.